Good morning and welcome to worship at Seven Locks Baptist Church. We are so glad and excited to have you worship with us today on the last day in February. It is great to be together, whether you are here in the sanctuary with us or connecting with us online at home. Wherever you are, we come together now to lift up the name of Jesus, to worship, to praise, to thank God for the week behind us and prepare our hearts for the week ahead. We invite you now to join with us as we begin our time of worship.
Our first song this morning is One Thing Remains, so please stand and join us.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from 1 John chapter 2, verses 3 through 11. First John chapter 2, verses 3 through 11. We know that we have come to know him if we keep his commands. Whoever says, I know him, but does not know or does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in that person. But if anyone obeys his word, love for God is truly made complete in them. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. Dear friends, I am not writing to you a new command, but an old one which you have had since the beginning. This old command is the message you have heard. Yet I am writing you a new command. Its truth is seen in him and in you, because the darkness is passing and the true light is already shining. Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates his brother or sister is still in the darkness. Anyone who loves their brother and sister lives in the light, and there is nothing in them to make them stumble. But anyone who hates a brother or sister is in the darkness and walks around in the darkness. They do not know where they are going because the darkness has blinded them.
Our next song this morning is Joyfully, so please stand and join us.
And
And you can be seated.
All right, now, before I share the word with you this morning, we have a special music, another solo that Raymond Tate has recorded that we would like to share with you now. And so please sit back and enjoy Raymond as he sings "The Love of God."
The love of God is with the heart of the Lord, and the Lord of God is with the heart of the Lord. I wish to have the Lord of God. I will declare above the heaven, a clear song of you. The turning tide, we reconcile, and pardon God's sins. O love of God, how rich and glorious, how much you love.
Thank you, Raymond, for sharing that with us. I invite you now to join me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray. Lord God, we love you. Lord, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for your grace and mercy. God, we thank you for your love, which truly never fails. God, it is inexhaustible. It never runs out, and it really does never give up on us. Lord, we pray that you would help us to understand just how important it is to live in that love and to share it with others, God, and to thank you because it's that love which brings us together, which unites us. It's the love that helps us to dig deeper and to be patient and to find a way forward where none seems possible. Lord, open our hearts to receive that love today. We love you and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So way back, long ago, in the dark ages of the early 2000s, there was a program on a cable network that I believe is still around called VH1. And they used to do a show called Behind the Music, where they would take a famous artist and profile their rise to stardom, how they got going, and they would tell you a lot of different things. Now, and back in the day, they did a lot of classic rock bands, and it's really weird to think of the music that I grew up on in the 80s as now being called classic rock. It even makes me feel older to know that songs from the distant past of 1998, when I graduated from high school, are now also considered to be oldies. Because then I think, what does that make me? Not cool, don't answer. But the thing that I loved about these programs is that it would tell you a lot of different things about the band. And one of my favorite things was it would always tell you things that you didn't know. It would give you further insight and be like, wow, I did not know that. Have you ever had that experience where you're watching a show or reading a book, a biography about someone that one of your favorite writers, actors, athletes, you name it. I mean, you can even apply it to painting. I don't know how many people would apply it to mimes, but maybe a couple. But you can read all of these different things and find out about them something you didn't know. And it gives you a greater appreciation for who they are and their work. And this week, as I was doing a deep dive into 1 John, I found out some more things about one of my favorite authors, which is John. I told you last week, John is probably my absolute most favorite book in the New Testament, the whole Bible. James is a close second, not to discount any of Paul's works because I like them too, but John just has always resonated with me. And I love the Gospel of John because as much as people say John presents this glorified state of who Jesus is as God, to me, as you read the Gospel of John, you find these up-close stories that actually highlight Jesus's humanity. The fact that the Son of God is completely God while he walks this earth, but he's a human being as well. And it makes to me Jesus more approachable, and I'm able to connect with him. And John wrote this. And because John showed this intimate picture of who Jesus is, I've always felt a kinship with John. So as I was studying the other books that bear his name, the letters of John, and finding out more about what happened to John as he aged, after he wrote the Gospel of John, as he was teaching in the churches that he founded around the city of Ephesus. You would be shocked to know that the churches that John founded in Ephesus never grew to the great heights like the church in Antioch that Barnabas and Paul founded together. You know, Antioch, for the next 200 to 300 years, during that early formative stage of the church, becomes the leading place of theology and teaching. And this is the church that's training pastors and missionaries. That's our term now. They didn't exactly use it back then, but these are the people who were going out from Antioch. John's churches are not big. John's churches are not doing all of these things. In fact, John dealt with a great deal of controversy. There was a lot of frustration and a lot of things that as John aged, he had to unpack and he had to reteach. Now, John is still very much has a great impact on our faith today and what God spoke through him. But to ask the question, was John a successful pastor? I don't know that from our modern standards or maybe even that of the first century, you would say that, but you would definitely say that he was faithful. He was faithful in doing what he believed that Jesus had called him to do when he was still a fisherman. And he was living in that as he aged, as he was an older man, caring now for younger Christians and dealing with different challenges as the church approached the second century. So what we're going to find today as we walk through this is the overarching message of 1 John is a call to remind people who God is. And we know God through his son, Jesus, that Jesus is the Son of God, fully God, fully human, but human nonetheless, walking, living among us, died on the cross, rose from the dead. That's Jesus. And that the standard for who we are to be in our faith is to emulate, to imitate, to be like Jesus. And one of the key elements and aspects of who Jesus is love. He loves other people. He loved other people. He treated them with compassion. That does not mean he never had conflicts with people. But even in his conflicts, he deals with it in a loving and gracious manner. And that's important because now John is dealing with a lot of Christians who have decided that they don't want to get along. They want to fight. They want to argue. There is a group within John's church that has left and is teaching a doctrine apart from that of Jesus Christ as fully God and fully human. And John has to challenge that and challenge them in that, but saying to even to his faithful followers, look, this is what the truth is. And this is how the truth lives. And it's in love. And that's the love that holds us together as the church. And we're going to explore this again today as we dive back in to this passage where John says, let me be really honest with you. Understand this. That to really understand what the truth is and to live correctly, it's Jesus. It's to follow Jesus. It's to live like him. It's to be like him. And anything apart from that, that's not Jesus. That's not what it is. We are called to live in a certain way, to live like him. If you want to know, if you have any questions about what your faith is and if it's real and genuine, you know this by the fact that the Holy Spirit has changed your hearts and your lives and given you a desire to live like Jesus, to live in that truth. And if that is what's happening, then and that obedience is taking root, then you see that there is a love for God and the love of God is flowing through you. But let me be real honest with you. Those who claim that they know the truth yet hate their brother or their sister, they're not telling the truth. They're lying because that is inconsistent with who Jesus is and what he did. In fact, they are stumbling in the dark. They're blind. If you live like Jesus, then you love. Then you model his way of life. And if that is the case, then you are living in the light, living as Jesus did. But if you hate your brother or your sister, then you are blind. You are stumbling around in the darkness, and that darkness is deep. And you're entrenched in it because the love of God is what opens our eyes. So, John's gospel is the last gospel to be written. And some of the reason for that is John is the longest living disciple. If you study church history, and some of it is church folklore, you will discover that most of the disciples are rumored to have died, to have been killed or martyred. Of the 11 that remained after Judas Iscariot hung himself in the Gospels, the other 11, not counting Matthias, who was added to the fold, 10 of them have said to have been martyred at a young age. Peter being one of the most famous that church history and church folklore regards as being crucified upside down. And the others met their ends in all fairly violent ways. And only John is said to have made it to a ripe old age in Ephesus as the founder of these churches there. And so as he's getting older, his disciples come to him and say, hey, John, you got to write this stuff down. People need to know your experience with Jesus long after you're gone. I mean, and you think about what would have been lost to history had John not written those words. I mean, I think about one of my favorite chapters from the book of John, John 15. I am the vine, you are the branches. If someone remains in me, I remain in them. But apart from me, you can do nothing. You will bear much fruit, but if you remain in me, but apart from me, there's nothing. Later in that chapter, I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know what his master does. Now I call you friend because I've told you everything and you are my friends if you do what I've taught you. Think about, and there's a lot of other passages, John 3:16 we talked about last week. So John records this. It's the last gospel, and it's different than Matthew, Mark, and Luke because they all follow a certain framework because they are using a common set of sources that help them kind of set the pace for the stories that they tell, even though they're all a little bit different, too. They're much more similar than John. So John's gospel gets circulated, and there are a lot of people that receive it quite well, but then there are others even within John's church who misunderstand it. And about that time, there is a new heresy, and it's not new to us now, it's been around forever, but at the time it was very new, and that in the form of Gnosticism, which was a teaching that said in order to know God, you had to know all of these different facts about God, and you had to be able to recite them in the afterlife to get past the various guardians of the afterlife. And the Gnostics used the Gospel of John to say, see, this validates our viewpoint that Jesus was the first Gnostic. And John says, no. And there was another heresy called Docetism, which said that Jesus only appeared to be a human being, but was always spiritual. And one of the essential tenets of both of these false teachings is that the spirit was good and the flesh was evil, completely and totally. That is not the teachings of Jesus. Now, he does say that our flesh, our fallen nature, is something that has to be redeemed and has to be renewed. But it's not the same. That's not apples to apples. So John writes his letters, as most scholars believe, or some scholars have posited, that John writes these letters as a commentary on his gospel to help unpack what's going on and help set right these ideas that are trying to link themselves to his gospel. And John's calling them out and saying, no, this is false. And there are two main themes that you find in the gospel and the letters of John. Number one, specifically in John 1, is who is Jesus? He is the Son of God, both fully God and fully human at the same time. Now, this is not fully expressed at this moment, but this is who Jesus is. And also, this is the important part of what Jesus did. And if you want to know if you have a relationship with God, if the Holy Spirit has changed your life or is changing your life, then you will know this by your love and compassion for others. Now, granted, John is not advocating here that, oh, once you accept Christ, you automatically just start loving people. No, it's something you grow in. It's spiritual muscles that you have to build, but you know that you need to build them. It's that inner conviction that comes from the Spirit, which John is talking about here. And John's letters are important because at the end of the first century, going into the second, it's the Wild West in terms of the church and theology and the way we think. There are so many things we take for granted now. I mean, the New Testament is hundreds of years from being established. So at the end of the first century, there's not just Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John floating around. There's some other gospels that some even written long after this that are fabrications that contain teachings that are actually counter to that of Jesus. And so John is writing this to clear up the issues that people all across the known world at the time were experiencing with the gospel to set the record straight. But he's also addressing locally elements within Ephesus, within his own church, that have broken away. They've said, we believe in the Gnostic stuff, and even John's gospel proves us right, that it's all about what you know about God, and because we know these things about God, we are superior, and that's all that matters is this knowledge and our conduct, and who we are has little bearing. So if we want to look down and condemn people, then we're going to go for it. And John says, let me be real honest with you. That's a bunch of hootenanny, to use an old Texas term. It's just false. It's not who Jesus is. If you want to say you have a connection and a relationship with God, well, that will be evident in how you live. Do you live like Jesus? Do you view the world the way God does? Are your eyes being open to the things of the Spirit? Now, John is, he does talk as you get later in this text about if you are following Christ. Says this in 3 and 4. He says, if you have a relationship with Jesus, then you'll have a desire to sin less, to stop sinning, to move away from that, to understand that the ways of the past need to be that, the ways of the past. But ultimately, the one thing that John hangs his hat on in 1 John throughout the whole text about, okay, this is who Jesus is. He's the Son of God. He died for our sins, rose from the dead. He set the standard for the way we ought to live, to show us what a human being should be and what a human being is in a perfect relationship with God, and a picture of what we will be on the other side of eternity. But this is the process of what God has called us to be in the process of becoming now. That's the first thing he says, but you know it by love. Love unites and connects. And John says that you know that you have this relationship with God because you can't hate people anymore. And if you do, it hurts. You have to work at it. And you know it's not right. And you will constantly be led back to a place of, okay, I can't stay here. And that's the issue that John says, is that, wait a minute. You people who want to break away and cause disruption and start fights and bust up the church that God has brought together because you claim you have a better understanding of the truth. Well, let me break that down for you. If that's the case, how can you hate people? How can you act superior? How can you discredit and write off and just push people aside because of your knowledge? If you say you know Jesus, that's just a lie, because that's not what Jesus did. That's not who Jesus is. Constantly, Jesus looks at people, even those who opposed him, even those who refused to believe him. He looks at them with compassion. And John can speak with great authority with that because he was there. He was there. He heard the man pray. He saw the heartbreak in his eyes as the Pharisees opposed him. Even the people who acted like they were too good to be around Jesus still had a compassion for him. John saw and understood the motivation when he cleansed out the temple, when he flipped tables. John said there was a reason for that. It wasn't because he hated those people. It was love that moved him forward. It was love for all of us that he prayed. Not that he would take us out of the world, but that he would protect us. That the Father would protect us and prepare us for the purpose at hand. It was love. I mean, John was sitting right next to Jesus when Jesus and Peter are having their talk in John 21. The man who denied knowing him. John heard Jesus say, Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord. You know in all things that I love you, then feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord. You know that I do. Then take care of my lambs. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Jesus. You know that I do. Then feed my sheep. It's love that motivates Jesus to look at the man who claimed to be one of his closest followers. After he denied him, after he ran and hid like a coward, to say on the lake shore that morning in John, the events recorded in John 21, after he asked that question three times, two words that changed Peter: follow me. So as John is talking about all of these things, he's an old man now. And sure, he probably forgets where he left his sandals, and he probably forgets what he had for dinner last night. But he does not forget that Jesus is love. And you know that because if you continue to read through this letter, he says it. He says, God is love. I know God is love because I know his son. His son is my best friend. And I saw the love that he talks about is hard. It's not fun. It's a love that when you are being brutally murdered, and that's the physical side, but not even talking about the spiritual side where your very soul is being ripped apart and your heavenly Father turns his back on you. There's a love within someone that cries, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I was there. I saw it. I'm telling you, that's a love. And that's how you know that your heart's being changed. When you just can't be that way anymore, you just can't hate people. You have to be something else. That's how you know that your life has been changed by God. And so John breaks this down, and that's why he says you just can't hate your brother or sister. You can't look this way. You can't be this way. You can't regard people in the same manner. Because if you do, that's lies. That's falsehood. And that's just simply not who God is. And you can't live your life that way. And anybody that teaches you that they know God and they know who He is and they know what everything's about and all that kind of good stuff, they're not being honest. So what do we do with this text? What's the take home for us? Well, it reminds us that one of the central and focal points of who it is to follow Christ is love. It is the most central thing, a love for God. We know that our faith is real. We know that when we ask for God's forgiveness, that it's granted, and how we respond. Now, granted, like I said, that learning to love one another, it's a muscle. And it's one that is a spiritual muscle that God constantly is exercising and stretching and growing and molding. And we will not love perfectly. That is beyond the realm of our ability as human beings. Now, one day when we have been glorified in heaven, then we'll be able to love perfectly because we'll be made completely new as God promises us, as Jesus promises us. But now we're learning this process. But knowing who we are as the church means that we learn to love, that we learn how to love each other, how to be a church family. That's what holds us together. But it's also what sends us out. Because after the events of the last year, this is a time where I believe that God is calling us as the church to be a voice of love with so much turmoil and so many different kinds of emotional responses to 9 or 10 different issues over the last year. People are raw, they're beat up, they're frustrated, and it seems like the ability to have a conversation within our own country is breaking down. And then you have another group that are perpetually offended by everything. And what's the church's response to this? It's God is calling us to be those who go in love, not simply with words, but that as things continue to get better, we invite people back to the table, both right now over the phone, Zoom, or socially distanced, but eventually to sit down again and eat together, drink coffee together with people who don't agree with us or maybe don't even believe like us, respecting their freedom to believe differently. Or worship differently, but still inviting them to the table. Because you know what's funny? And you can see the difference between the physical realm and how the worldly mindset of how things that are not of God do business and the way God does. Is we have a culture that has elevated words. That words, while yes, they are important because it's how we communicate. But words are everything, and one word said 40 years ago can get you fired. One word, a conversation can mean that, you name it. You can't eat in a restaurant anymore at certain places, whatever it would be. But words are have been elevated to the point that they're separated from actions, and that's the problem. Because John doesn't do that. John says, look, talk is cheap. And yes, Jesus said a lot of things, but you need to know how he lived, because that's the key. Because how Jesus lived, what he did, the way he reached out to people is what changed the world. And that's how God is calling us to continue to change the world, is to respond in love, to go and to have conversations that are weird, to go and just listen, to go and be present with people who are hurting. That is what brings people together, and that's what God is calling us to do out in the community. But also it's a call to us as the church to continue banding together I mean, a great miracle has happened in so many churches over the last year. Even when we've been apart, we've not been able to gather, or we're gathering in limited capacity for the time being, there is still something that connects us, and it is the love of Jesus Christ. And it's that love that we must hold on to with every fiber of our souls and allow that to change how we respond to each other and how we reach out to the community, because our world is in need of healing. And I know that God is calling us as the church to be that healing force, because we have the one thing that can heal, and that is Jesus, the Son of God, crucified for all of our sins, risen from the dead, with the promise in that resurrection of God's grace, a change within our hearts now, and a promise of resurrection one day, of a newness to come in the life long after this one ends. Let's pray. Lord God, we love you. We thank you for your grace and mercy. We thank you for your love. God, we ask that you would continue to allow that love to flow through our hearts and our souls, to shape us, to change us, so that we would be able to respond both within our church and within our community with your grace and mercy. Lord, we love you, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our next song this morning is hymn number 344, Jesus Loves Me, so please stand and join us.
And as we sing, everything, I'm going to have to get on to my roadie. My roadie is me. So as we sing this morning, knowing that we're a church that's represented with many different cultures, and this is a song that is well known. And so we invite you at any point during at the chorus, you want to sing in the verse, but especially the chorus, to sing Jesus Loves Me in any language that you are comfortable with. But that does not include Pig Latin. But any other recognized language, we invite you to sing. If you know Spanish, Japanese, Korean, Tagalog, whatever it might be, and many others, Greek that are represented, Farsi, French, please, we lift up the name of Jesus, and we sing about his love in any language, because we know that God knows them all. So let's sing this together.
Yes, Jesus, come please.
We want to thank all of you for worshiping with us today, whether you are online or you are here in the sanctuary. It's great to be gathered in the name of Jesus. And this is the time I'm going to pan the camera around and let everybody wave. So I want to prepare everybody for that. But, you know, it's amazing that even though we're outside today, it's dark and gloomy, it is great to gather in the name of Jesus because we know that the light of Christ shines. Where two or more are gathered in his name, we know that the Spirit is with us. And so we celebrate and we worship that today. And now we want to say that where two or more are gathered, we know that you are connecting with us online too. So we want to wave and say hello to you this morning. Everybody wave. In your bulletin today, you will see announcements about Easter lilies. I invite you to take a look at that. Also remind you about our various ministries, our small group Bible study that meets with the Tates at 9:30 on Sunday mornings, as well as our Spanish Bible study that meets via conference call at 10 a.m. And then our Wednesday night prayer and Bible study that is typically at 6:30, we call it Refuel Now. We're actually taking a brief hiatus from that while we have our Lenten Bible study. I will be sending out the Zoom link for that. We had a great time this past Wednesday night. That is from 7 to 8 on Zoom. I'll have the link for that. If you are watching this and you would like to be included in that, please send us an email at 7LocksBaptistChurch@gmail.com. And we would love to connect with you in that way. You can also send us a message via Facebook as well. So as we close our time of worship today, we're going to sing a portion of Joyfully. Oh, Passport, yes. If you're a youth and you would like to go to Passport Camp, be sure and contact Lindsay and let her know, because the time for putting in our deposit is getting closer. So please reach out to Lindsay about that. As we close now, we are going to sing a portion of Joyfully again. So we invite you to sing with us as we close out our time of worship together today. Thank you for worshiping with us. Go in peace and serve the Lord. If you're in person, please wait for our usher to come and dismiss you by row. But if you're online, thank you so much for worshiping with us. We will see you again soon. Bye-bye.